Akhandamandalakaram Vyaptam Yena Characharam Tatpadam Darshitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Hari Om. Om Namo Bhagavate Sri Ramakrishnaya. Dear devotees, my respectful and loving greetings to Swami Shantatmanandaji. He gave a beautiful introduction. Of course, I do not have the magic wand to make the ego exit immediately, but yes, this is very interesting from the point of view of psychology. What is ego and how it operates? If you want to study ego, then the best help is that we get from the subject of psychology, because it speaks or it analyzes about our mind. Ego is one of the component of our subtle body. Ahankara, as Sanskrit word says. So in Shankaracharya very beautifully brings out in 5-6 verses the nature of ego. In Drik Drishya Vivek, a small booklet, you can find it here, very nicely explains that. This ego is something in our everyday life very, very useful. But we have been hearing that ego is bad, ego should not be kept up, ego has to be renounced, one must get out of this ego. All these things we are hearing again and again, but in our day-to-day life, this ego gets predominantly powerful, and without which then none of the work can go on. Once I met a Swami in one of our centers in Bihar. So I was sitting with him. So he said, Swami Amukananda, I don't want to tell his name. And he was telling me while talking that Swami Amukananda is going to Belur Math tomorrow. So I was thinking somebody else. Then I thought, hey, this is not your name? He said, yes, my name, because I don't say I. So I always say about that Swami. So that created confusion in my mind. So in our day-to-day dealings, if all of us start telling our names instead of I, what will happen, you see? That I, that very one syllable letter, that is so useful in our interactions. So in our journey in spiritual life, one end is this ego and another is the self. I mean with the capital S. That self. So Atman. Atman is another end. And from the ego we start journeying. And how this ego is transformed and become minimum and become less and less and less and finally disappears and self only remains is all the spiritual journey. Now, there are a lot of explanations and analysis has been done in Western psychology as well as our Hindu psychology. And Vedanta especially, because it deals with the mind, and lot of questions have been come up in Mandukya Upanishad, in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, etc. And those are very, very highly technical to discuss about this Ahankara. Then I was thinking, by grace of Mother, I thought, should I go into the technicality of this ego or should I make it a very simple, understandable and which will be useful for our life by quoting some examples. So I thought I took the later path today because every week you are having class here. Swami Shantatmananji is giving you the so much of knowledge about Vedanta from the books and from the great savants of yore. He takes out those bhashyas and he is a very well-read Swami. So, he is giving you all the technicalities. So today, I am going to quote you four incidents. Two incidents from the recent past and two incidents from the long, long past to the Puranic age I am going to take you. So, this ego, can it be completely removed? A question comes up in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna very clearly says, it cannot be completely rooted out so long the body consciousness is there. If it cannot be rooted out, then should it stay and bring all difficulties for our spiritual life? Then he says, very beautifully in Bengali, he says, Takshala Dasoye. That is the solution he gives. If it cannot be removed, let the rascal remain as a servant. Dasoye. As a servant, let him remain. Who will remain? That ego. Let him remain. It doesn't matter. But let it remain as a servant. Are you able to realize that your ego is strong? I ask these questions and I introspect myself. We are attaching ourselves to many things, to situations, to people, and to objects. These are the three things our attachment goes into. Our mind takes the form of that object or that situation or that person and then attaches itself. So my ego is partly transferred to the other outside external object. This is my ashram. When I say that, my ego has extended itself and engraved into that building, this ashram. If you say this is my car, your ego has transposed to that car and that car becomes you. So if any slight scratch happens in the car, you get upset. It has not affected you in any way. Neither it has affected your physics nor your mind, nothing. But a scratch on the car gives you so much of anger because you have gone out into it. That means your ego, your I-ness has gone into it and taken it possession. So likewise our attachment goes on. So I told you that I am not going to the technicalities of this ego, but I will quote you four instances. One incident that happened in the life of the great Swami Ritajanandaji. I do not know any of you have seen him. If some of you have seen him, you are blessed indeed. I had the opportunity to serve him when I was placed in Seva Pratishtan, the biggest mission hospital in Calcutta. I served him there. And he used to tell me lots of stories. And we, some of the brahmacharis and swamis, we used to go to him after meals. And then he would just slant on the bed and then he would tell us stories. One such story I want to tell you, how wonderful, if you practice your sadhana, you are definite to pick up when the ego rises in your mind. Even though it is a bubble, at that moment, you can feel that your ego is rising. So he told a story. What is that said? Incident? Once he was in Paris, you know, for many years he was in France. And he was, at the age of 56 or 55, he was posted to Paris. Now he was telling us, at that old age, how do I learn a language? If it is an English-speaking place, there is no problem. But in France, you have to learn French. And at this old age, how can I learn the language? It was a big problem for him. But then Madhavananji said, no, you can do it. Go. Like that he sent him. So he had no other way. He went. And then after going there, he started picking up the language. And to his great surprise, in 16 months, he could speak fluently French language. And he started giving lectures in French language in 2 years' time. In 5 years, he used to speak in French language in the universities, attending to the great you know, scholars. And that was the day when he returned after giving a very successful lecture in the university. He came back to ashram. He felt, ah, what a wonderful thing I have done. I did not know this language 5 years before. And today, I am able to speak to the university students and professors. I am preaching Sri Ramakrishna in this country. That's why Sri Ramakrishna has sent me here. This is a very valid assumption for anybody. If you do a good work, naturally you give a pat behind you and said, ah, you have done well. And you feel very happiness. Is it not? That's what happened to him. But he was a spiritual aspirant. And that too, evolving soul, not a stranded soul. So he would immediately understand the ego has come. Now he felt the ego must go because it is going to do a lot of harm to him. So he went before Sri Ramakrishna's picture, sat there and wept and wept and wept. Said, oh master, the ego has come into me. I am preaching you. That is the ego. Please nip it in the bud. Otherwise, I am lost. When he said this, you know, Sri Ramakrishna listens. We all know in our daily life, we have seen how our prayers have been listened by Sri Ramakrishna. So the same thing happened because Sri Ramakrishna loved this child. He said, okay, I will nip it in the bud. But then the nipping is not very easy, is not smooth, may not be very pleasant. But then the nipping has to be done. So what happened was, 1 week after, he was driving somewhere and the devotee was driving the car. He was sitting next to him. The car got into trouble and it stopped somewhere in the where the fields are there. So he got down. It was sunset time. He was feeling thirsty. Looking around here, there was one house at a distance. Then he thought, let me go and ask for a glass of water. Because I knew French, there is no problem in asking in French. So let me go. So he knocked the door. And he says, a 10-year-old girl came and opened the door. And she asked in French, what do you want? He said, I am very thirsty. Can you give me a glass of water? He said, oh yes, please come in. She took him inside and he went and sat in that house. It's a big house like a mansion. And only one girl is there. Small girl there too. She brought a glass of water, he drank. He asked, where are your parents? My parents have gone for work. They will come in 1 hour time. Are you staying alone in this big house? That was another next question. The girl said, no. My grandpa is there upstairs. Would you like to meet him? He thought, this girl opened the door not only, she gave the glass of water also. So I must go and tell the grandpa, thanks. This is normal, you know, courtesy. So let me go to him. So she took him upstairs. It was like a big room where the door you enter. So it was a room like this. That when you enter, the door, straight there was a cot. And in that cot, an old man was lying down. So he went near to him. He didn't see anything. The door opened and he straight went to the cot and where the old man was there. He talked to him in French and the old man was very happy. He said, oh, my granddaughter gave you a glass of water. It's so normal only. It's a courtesy for a human being, etc., etc. Then he asked, you seem to be from India. Are you from India? He said, yes. I am from India. Who are you? It's all right. See, it's not sometimes you do not know how to put it off. And you think you have put it off and it is not off. So
ha 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 ha. They are having a practical demonstration of operation.
No, someone can go and help that lady who can just put it off. Yes, the phone, sir. Yes, please go there. It's a good help, you know, to her. Yes. Then, yes, this, where is the clock? Oh, here it is. Then this person was telling, oh, you are from India. Who are you? I am a Hindu monk, he said. Then he looked at him and said, are you a Ramakrishna monk? Ritajanaji said, Pani Pani ho gaya, kahte na, Hindi mein. I said, you are shivering. You know Ramakrishna monk? What are you talking? When I was a college student, for the first time in our college library, I read Roma Roland's book on Sri Ramakrishna. From that time onwards, I have become a devotee of Sri Ramakrishna. Turn back and see on the wall. He turned back on the wall. There's a big picture of Sri Ramakrishna in that house. He says, Sri Ramakrishna nipped my ego in the butt because I was thinking I am preaching Sri Ramakrishna in France. Nobody has done this job better than me. While Sri Ramakrishna has preached himself and he's sitting there before my going there and years before he came. He said, on that day, then he is telling, look, some of you may go to foreign countries and some of you may be given this charge of preaching Sri Ramakrishna. Never take it to your mind and your heart that you are preaching Sri Ramakrishna. If anybody comes to know of Sri Ramakrishna through you, blessed you are. Not that you are taking him. It is his wish that person has come to you and learnt about Sri Ramakrishna. That was a stunning, revealing truth for me because we are all youngsters and we learned from Ritajananji. This is the latest, recent past. Little if you go back, I would like to tell about this egolessness of Sister Nivedita. Do you know today is the 150th birth anniversary of Sister Nivedita? 28th October is a wonderful day, and I am coming from Dublin, Ireland, which is Sister Nivedita's birth country. And should I not speak about her? One incident. I met one gentleman, Dr. Siddharth Sen. He is the grandson of Dr. Dhiren Sen of Calcutta University during Sister Nivedita's time. This he was telling about his grandfather. I said, hey, your grandfather was so close to Nivedita because in Nivedita's books we find him coming and talking to Nivedita about the Bengali language and Bengali culture. He wrote two volumes on the origin and development of Bengali language in those days during Nivedita's time. And that book was a prescribed postgraduate level in Calcutta University in Bengali language. So he was very famous and he was very close to Nivedita. And one day, his grandson is now in Dublin. He's a great mathematician. Even Nobel laureate mathematicians come to him and discuss with him about the problems in mathematics. Siddhartha is an 86-year-old man. And when I went to Dublin for the first time, I stayed in his home for 3 days. Wonderful person. So, I'm telling you why this person, this Dr. Dhiren Sen, his grandfather, he was very close to Nivedita. One day he came to Nivedita in Bhospara Lane and said, my dear sister, I have translated my own book into English from Bengali. But my English is not very thorough like yours. I admire your English because you know how wonderful Nivedita's English is. Even any small book you take up and read Nivedita, and the English is so flowing and so wonderful it is. I always admire her English. And she, your English is so good, you must see these two books and seek, make some correction. Nivedita said, sir, I am ready to do this job, but what compensation will you give me? Dr. Dhiren Sen was stunned. You want compensation? You want some money? How many pounds you want? I will get from London, not Indian rupees. Pounds I will get you. How many you want? How much you want? Nivedita said, now come to my right line. I say to you, when you publish this English work, in your introduction, you should never mention my name. That is the prize I want. Think of Sister Nivedita. You are ashamed to clap or what? One person only clap. Or they are afraid to clap, I think. Our Shantatmanji is very strict, you know, in clapping, etc. So they are not very free to clap. So, Sister Nivedita says, my name should not be mentioned anywhere in the book. I will go through it. I will correct it. I will give you. And that book is still there. And you can see in the foreword, he mentions, I am indebted to a foreign lady who did not want her name to be mentioned. He says like that. But if you know that he was friendly to Sister Nivedita, you can find out that. But Sister Nivedita was such that where was her ego? This was a grand lesson that she learned after coming into contact with Swamiji. Swamiji taught her and gave her the best name, Nivedita, one who has been dedicated. It's a past tense, Nivedita, dedicated, the one who is dedicated. See, that dedication comes only when the ego is subsided. If the ego is grand, you can never get dedication. We all find sometimes difficulty in our karma yoga. We all do a lot of actions. Many good things we do to the society, to ourselves, to the families. And still you see that because of the ego rising high, we cannot dedicate ourselves to the work that we are given to. Our dedication is absent. Because dedication is absent, we are unable to concentrate. And because we are unable to concentrate, the work is not coming as it should come out. So, the root cause is ego. And the ego can be slowly, slowly subsided. And that is what Nivedita did. Is this not a wonderful example for all of us? You do some good thing to people, don't expect anything in return. If you expect anything in return, you are having ego, and that ego is going to trouble you. Now, I have told you the distant past and gone. The distant past, two examples are there. I will tell you one of the examples of Hanuman. Do you know in Ramayana, there is only one character, if you want to see, completely selfless, and that is Hanumanji. It's so beautiful. It says that one Pandit was telling, when I was hearing, I used to go and hear the Hanuman stories. So, in my childhood, in Madras, so one Pandit was a great Kathakalachapa artist he was. His name was Kripananda Variyar. And Variyar used to speak so beautifully the stories of Ramayana, Mahabharata, etc. He gave one incident about Hanumanji. And that struck me when I was a small child. What was the story? Ram has come back to Ayodhya. Ravana, Vada, etc. over. Now Ayodhya is doing very well. Ram, Sita, Lakshman, Bharat, all are there. Because one Ram lady is sitting. I remember the Ram story here. She greets me as Ram Ram, so that's why I remember that. And when that Sita was walking in the bagan, in the garden, Ram was there, Lakshman was there, and Hanumanji was there. Hanumanji always comes behind. He is not in front, he's in the behind, and where the master goes, he will follow. His master is only Sri Ram. He is not bothered about Lakshman, Bharat, Shatru, etc. And then he's walking, and Ram Sita walking in front. And Sitaji, in a very great nostalgic moment, she is talking about her days in that garden of Ashokvan, of Ravana. She was talking to Rama, how much I was suffering there, and every moment I was thinking about you. I was thinking when you will come and release me. Like that she was telling. But then this Hanuman came, and what all he did. Not only he kept fire to the Lanka, he gave me the solace by telling me, yes, Ram will come. And he promised me that you are coming. And because of Ram, I kept my prana, she says. At that time, slowly it is heard by everybody. Lakshman also heard it and he kept quiet. But Hanumanji is hearing. She immediately jumped in front of them. Hanumanji said, Mother, please don't say lie in presence of our master. Sri Ram is Satya Sandhan. He is a Satya Purusha. Never he can tell a lie. No lie can stand in front of Sri Ram. And you are uttering a lie? Sita was aghast. Hey Hanuman, what are you telling? Am I telling a lie? Is it not that you gave fire to the entire Lanka? He says, no, Mother. No. If you had thought like that, it is wrong. Actually, you only kept the fire on Lanka, not me. Then Sita says, how it is possible? Then that poet quoted this verse of Tulsidas, Ullanga Sindhu Salilam Salilam Yashoka Vahne Janakatma Jayaha Adaya Tenaiva Dadaha Lankam Namamitam Pranjali Ranjaneyam. This is a very beautiful verse as Tulsidas has written. He says, Dada means what? He burnt. Yes, Hanumanji burnt. How did he burn? Ullanga Sindhu Salilam Salilam. Salilam means water. Water means ocean. And Salilam means with a child's play for him. It was not a difficult work for him. It was child's play to jump over the ocean. And he went there, Ullanga. He crossed over the ocean. And what he did? Ullanga Sindhu Salilam Salilam. Yashoka Vahni Janakatma Jaya. Janakatma. Who is Janakatma? Janaki. Janaki's Shokagni. That is what was there. He found there. What he found in Sita? Sita was completely suffering. Shoka. And that Shoka has turned into Agni. Shoka Agni. Adaya Tenaiva. What Hanuman did? He took that Shoka Agni from her and burnt Lanka. So Hanumanji said, Mother, can it be I burnt? Can you say this? You see, that ego is zero. One person you find in our scriptures, if anyone can compete with Hanuman, none can compete in becoming in zero in his ego. Completely selfless. What a wonderful example before us. That's why Swamiji was so fond of Hanuman. He tells, let Hanuman be the ideal for the youth of India, he says. Let Hanuman temples come up everywhere. In every house, you must have a Hanuman picture. If you can have, you know what effect it has got. How many people recite Hanuman Chalisa? In South Africa, I was there nearly 8 years. Every child there knows Hanuman Chalisa. Every child and every devotee knows Hanuman Chalisa by heart. Anywhere you ask them to recite Hanuman Chalisa, they will recite. What a wonderful, that poem itself, so wonderful it is. Written by again Tulsidas. So, that Hanuman, you find, is a great example for us. If you put idols, you know, nowadays in televisions, lot of idols shows are there. American Idol, you know. Even in Bangkok, when I went, that devotee put on that television set, Thailand idols are there. And Indian idols are there. Where are our ideals? Can you not bring our ideals back? Those ideals, you know, put into idols in Hanuman. What a wonderful example for us. Completely zero ego means Hanumanji. I feel like that. Now I go little farther than the Ramayana. Ramayana is, of course, epic. It is an itihasa. It's not a Purana. But then many Hindus confuse with Ramayana and Mahabharata as Puranas. I always, whenever I get chance, I repeat this. Ramayana and Mahabharata are not Puranas, they are Itihasas. So, I am going to one Purana. The Purana says about Mother Jagadatri. Jagadatri Puja is coming this month on 17th, I think. 17th or 16th? 17th. 17th is Jagadatri Puja. And I am very fond of Jagadatri Puja because Jagadatri Puja was being performed for many years in Ranchi TB Sanatorium where I was there. And 12 years I stayed there. One yuga in Bengali, they say. 12 years means one yuga. So one yuga I was there, and every year, without fail, by Mother's grace, Swami Shantatmanaji was the pujari. It's a wonderful, it's a great pleasure for me to tell you all, because whenever he used to come, the entire sanatorium would become enlivening. It would become very wonderful atmosphere would come, and people used to come, 22,000 people used to come and take prasad on the Navami day, on the Jagadadri Puja day. 22,000 people. I asked Jairam Bhatti, where the first Jagadadri Puja was started in the mission, how many people come? 12,000. I said, phew, nothing. Come to Ranchi Sanatorium, you get 22,000 people coming. What a wonderful place it was, you know. If you go to Ranchi, you please visit the sanatorium and see where Jagadatri is even now worshipped. And when his time, it was marvelous. From Suryoday to Suryast, from sunrise to sunset, he used to sit in one posture and do the puja. And then after 4:30 to 5:30 till sunset, he used to do the havan. It was a grand, grand occasion, I tell you. How much joy it brought. And the local tribals, you must see the tribals in their new dresses coming there and standing there. And they used to call Jagadatri Mela. It is really a Mela. In Belurmat Mela, you know, so many small, small stalls are there. Like that, we used to have plenty of stalls. And there, Swamiji used to come. So Jagadatri worship is one of the important worship in our Hindu tradition. Though it is not very popular in southern India and in the western India and even northern India, I should say. But eastern India, it has become very popular. And you can do even one day or you can do 3-day puja. Ashtami, Navami, Dashami you can do or you can do one day also. Ashtami, Navami, this Saptami, Ashtami, Navami, all the 3 days you can do one day. So it's a wonderful, beautiful puja. But I was interested. I went to one book called Tantrasar. It gives the story of Jagadatri. I said, why Jagadatri became so popular? Then I was thinking. But then I found Sri Ramakrishna gives a quote on Mother Jagadatri. Who is Jagadatri? He raises the question. And Ramakrishna himself answers the question. One who is holding this universe is Jagadatri. Holder means Dhatri. What she is holding? Not a pot of wealth. She is holding the entire universe in her hand. And the universe is in her hand. She is holding the universe. Jagat Dhatri. So she is called Jagat Dhatri. And that Jagat Dhatri story said, once upon a time, the Devas and Asuras had a big fight. You know that fight you get every now and then. Even in Sri Devi Mahatmyam, you got 3 stories are there, not 1 story. So these Devatas and Asuras, they always fight. And the fighting goes on, goes on, goes on. Sometimes some Devatas, some deity has to come, like either Vishnu or Shiva or Mother, Divine Mother herself has to come. So Divine Mother coming during the Mahishasur and then Shumbha Nishumbha, all those stories we all know from the Sri Chandi we learned. But this story says, once this fight was there, all the Devatas got victory. After getting victory, they all thought, my strength, because of that I won. Asmakam evayam mahimeti, Keno Parishad says. What the Devas are thinking, asmakam evayam vijayo, asmakam evayam mahimeti. We are glorious. We have won this war by our own strength and efforts. This is ego. This ego has come upon the devatas. So, if God is within you and you are really God-fearing and a spiritual person, then God takes compassion on you. And then he will nip it in the bud, that ego that comes. Here also same thing happened. Indra was there. Other devatas were there. And they were all telling that we have won this battle on our strength, forgetting the divine grace. Then Devi smiled. She said, let me teach these fellows one lesson. What she did? She came as a jyoti. You know, jyoti ra jyoti. We say, Swamiji uses this word in our Aarti song. Is it not? Jyoti ra jyoti, ujjala hridi kandara, he says. That jyoti ra jyoti came upon there as a ball of fire. It came and stood in Devaloka. So the news went to Indra. Indra said, what is that? Just now we have got our victory. And is there any other asur who has come to tackle us? Then it will be very difficult. We are now enjoying the victory. And now another asur has come or not. Who is that entity that has come in the form of jyoti? So he looked around his assistants. Then he said, who to send? Agni was stating like this. Agni was terribly egoistic on that day. You know, when you are egoistic, that ego will glisten in your eyes. Have you ever seen that? In others' eyes you must have seen, not in your own eyes. But it will glisten. It will come in your eyes and you will say, yes. You say, hey, one fellow came and told me, Swamiji, I have written a poem, so let me read it to you. I said, okay, I like Ravindranath poems, but then not everyone's poems, you see. But then I said, okay, read it to me. So he read it out. I said, yes, it was nice. He immediately said, Maharaj, I have written this. First you are told I have written a poem, and you read it out to me. I know very well that you have written it. And again, what is the necessary to emphasize? I have written this. I have not doubted you. That is the glistening of ego in your eyes. It comes. And everywhere you emphasize that I am beautiful. I am powerful. I have done this. I have not done. No, I have done this. It's a very big thing. Our great Swamis were there. And they have done very big work. And the ego comes very, unknowingly it comes. And while speaking, you can understand, oh, I have done this at that time. I have done this here at that time. So the ego is very normal. I won't tell it is bad, because ego, arising of ego, is the nature of the mind. Unless you go into the psychology of the mind, you will find the ego is only going to grow bigger and bigger, and finally it has to stop and then merge with the cosmic ego. And that is what we are travel in spiritual journey. But then this ego is coming, and then I am wondering what happened to him. And now you see, that is what Agni. So Indra said, Agni, you go and find out. So Agni went. It, the same story appears a little differently in Kenopanishad also. Must be Kenopanishad must be the origin, and the Puranas and Tantras are the later periods historically. So in Agni went there. So the Yaksha, when Agni went and said, who are you? Is the question he is asking the Yaksha. It's a form of Yaksha, as it is said. So the Yaksha replies in a female voice. The female voice comes out and said, what is your power? First she asked, who are you? He said, I am Agni. Aham Agni, he says. Aham, that aham comes everywhere. Agni. He says, not only aham, he says, Jataveduham iti, he says. Jataveduham, I am the all-knower. Agni says proudly, I know everything in this world. And you are asking me who I am? Is it not funny that you are asking me? You should have known me. Because I know everything and the whole universe knows me. That is the ahankar. Such was his ego, and he shouted at Yaksha. And Yaksha said, okay, cool down. Now do one thing. And the Yaksha just cut a blade of grass and placed it before Agni. What is your power? Toi kim viryam? It is asking. Kim Viryam, what is your tejas? What is your power? And he says, I can burn everything. Sarvam dadaham. He says, I can burn everything. You can burn everything? Okay, burn this blade of grass. And Agni comes and he smiles and laughs. You are challenging me like this? How many forests I have burnt? And you are asking me to burn a blade of grass? And Agni tried. And you know, he couldn't. The blade of grass was as it was kept there. He fell down and he put his head down and returned to Indra. Indra said, I can't. I can't, he says. Then, see, these stories, Puranic stories, have got great inner meanings. Tattvic meanings are there. If you can associate with tattvic meaning, then it becomes very interesting. Otherwise, only story, you know, Puranic stories, stories are stories. Here, Agni represents Panchendriyas. Because through Agni, we see. Our vision comes through Agni, you know that. All the Panchendriyas have got correlation with the Panchabhutas. From the each Bhuta comes one type of object of Indriya, that is, and then the object also comes. When this Drishya is there, then how I am seeing through my eyes, not through my ears. Five Indriyas have got five different functions. You can't superimpose one to another. So, through eyes you are seeing, and the jyoti is required, and that's why it has come, and jyoti, you could see. And then, the panchendriyas are represented by one Agni. So Agni includes all the other four indriyas. That is how the scholars explain. And when you know that, through that, you can't understand what is what. The panchendriyas have got limitations. It can grasp the object, and full knowledge of the object is not possible by the indriyas. What is truth behind the object? Say, for instance, Atman is everywhere. Atman behind this glass of water, I do not know. But then, through seeing this, I cannot get it. I cannot grasp. There must be something, Atindriya. There must be another, higher than the sense organs, you require some type of another sense organ, which is called Atindriya. It's called beyond that. So, this Agni came back. Now Indra looked. Whom to send? Now Indriyas failed. But then Indriyas are activated by what? By prana. These pancha pranas, you know, when you do offering, you say that you start with, you know, pancha prana, the swaha, you say pranaya swaha, apanaya swaha, vyanaya swaha, udanaya swaha, samanaya swaha. So these pancha pranas, they activate these pancha indriyas. If the pranas are weak, the indriyas also will be weak. So, this what is the panchendriyas? So, the pancha pranas are represented by vayu. So, Indra says, hey vayu, the indriyas have failed. That is, the agni has failed. Now, you go, if the prana can find out or not, because pranas are more powerful than the panchendriyas. Then vayu comes. The same argument takes place and the yaksha asks him, what are you? He says, I am Vayu. What is your power? Toi kim viryam, the same question. And Vayu says, I can topple everything in this world. I can topple down the mountains. I can throw away big trees. So he was telling, full of egoism. Then the yaksha says, okay, before you is a small blade of grass, just to throw it out. And Vayu was very angry because he is challenged for a small piece. And then he tried. But then he put all his effort, the Upanishad says, but he could not move an inch of that blade of grass. He goes back. Panchendriyas failed, pancha pranas failed. Now, the sattvika quality of the personality, which is turned as Indra, looks and he thinks. You see, if you are a Shuddha Buddhi, then you think, where I am going? So Indra is represented here as a Shuddha Buddhi. So he immediately thinks, hey, what is happening? Indriyas could not do, pranas could not do. Then let me myself go. Then he goes there. And when he went there, that Jyoti Surupa disappears. It disappears. Because even in sattva, you cannot have the vision of God. unless you go beyond the three gunas, vision of God is not possible. So in sattvic guna, you accumulate. When you are sattvic is there, full sattvika is not there. There is an element of tamas and rajas attached to it. So you cannot have the vision of God. So when the sattva also fails, that is Ramakrishna's, that three Robert story, you know. Even sattvika can go up to a limit only, and then it has to fail. It cannot take you. So that's what happened here. And then that light which disappeared before Indra appeared on the sky. The Upanishad says, as Uma, Himavan's daughter. It says, but Tantrasar says, it appeared as Jagaddhatri. So on the sky, Jagaddhatri was sitting on her lion and with the grand, you know, eight arms, that is Ashtabhuja, and she's sitting there and she's telling Indra, hey Indra, it is not possible to have the self-realization. Brahman cannot be recognized by Indriyas, by Pranas, by even the three Gunas. Brahman cannot be realized. So for the Brahman, which is completely inactive, and to the Jiva, what is the connection between them? So the Tantras, they say, it is the Shakti which is the connection between Jivatma and Paramatma. That's why Shakti worship has become very huge, successful. Because Shakti comes. And Shakti worship, that is what Sri Ramakrishna did. And he practiced Shakti worship. And the Shakti worship is the link between the Brahman realization and our Jivatma. And that's why it is said, the Tantra says, that Brahman appeared through her Shakti, through his Shakti, and that Shakti was Jagaddhatri. And Jagaddhatri said, you all were in delight and you are all agog with the success of the battle that you had done recently, but do you know I was behind your success? If my Shakti was not there behind the Astra, you would not have taken that Astra and killed that Asura. If my power was not there, nothing could have been happened. Shakti is behind everything. Do you understand? Like that she's telling. And then Indra says, yes, mother, I understand this. Because we are simply boasting about our talents, ourselves. I know these things, I do these things, etc. But nothing of these are going to save you. Because so long you are keeping on the ego, you cannot flourish. So, see, Ramakrishna says, there is, when this Jagaddhatri's picture, if you have seen, or the Murti, you must have seen the Murti, where you find the Simha, that is the lion, is putting its one foot on an elephant. And the elephant is killed there. And the red blood comes out from the elephant body. That is why the Murti, you will see that everywhere. So, see, Ramakrishna talks about this elephant. He says, Mon holo mottokari. Mottokari, that means a mad elephant. Our mind is mad elephant. And that mad elephant mind, that ego, has to be taken out. It should be killed. And then only Jagaddhatri comes. Or vice versa. When Jagaddhatri appears, when the Lord appears in your heart, you cannot have this ego. You will be the humblest of the humble person. Humblest of the humble. Trinadapi. You know that. So that Trinadapi, even humblest of the blade of grass, you will be the humblest. And that humility must come. If you develop the humility slowly, from whatever stage we are there now, it doesn't matter that I am at what stage of ego. It may be 100% or it may be 50% or it may be 20%. Whatever stage we are, we must realize first that there is ego in me and that is spoiling my victory. So when you understand that, then slowly, slowly curb this ego. Whenever you have that occasion, today I saw Sri Ramakrishna's beautiful decoration. Who did this decoration? Which lady, our devotee, has come and did that? She must have a very good idea about decoration. I say, Maharaj, I did that. You immediately tend to say that. Don't say that. When the urge to come to say, I did this, at that time just control yourself. Oh, let me not say this. Let him find out. Let the Swami find out who has done this? Let others say, Maharaj, this lady has given this idea. In Singapore, I do not know whether you see the Singapore website or the Facebook page. So beautiful. Every week, Saturday and Sunday, beautiful decoration. The decoration is not repeated, I tell you. Once decoration, that decoration is never repeated. Every week you have new decoration. And one lady does that. She does such a beautiful decoration there. And if you ask her, oh, today you have done so beautifully, and she will just put her head down. She would not say, yes, Maharaj, I have done it. She would not say. That is the nature, that is the sign of your spiritual progress. You may say, what is my spiritual progress? Nothing, I have done 20 years, I have taken initiation and doing japam. Maharaj, nothing I am saying. If you are behaving like this, that is your nature. That is the spiritual progress. We do not understand that. So much of progress is being done, we are not aware of it. Now, this Jagatatri, that's why Sri Ramakrishna says, Mattakari, that mad elephant of the mind, has to be brought down. So it is lying on the floor. Over that, the lion is there, the Vahan. And over that, mother is sitting. So Jagatatri, that concept, is for killing our ego. So long the ego is present, mother will not come in the heart, Sri Ramakrishna says. After talking about Jagatatri, he says this. So long the ego is present. So should we not find out the methods, how to take it out? I am not going to speak about the methods, because you are having lots of retreats and so many things, and so many learned swamis are coming. I just wanted to limit myself to tell you 4 instances and how the ego can be controlled. It is a possibility, it can be controlled. If it cannot be absolutely controlled, let it remain as my servant ego. This is what I want to thank Maharaj for giving the opportunity. Om Shanti, 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat, Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.